treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh,
well, good morning, everybody. I hope everybody's doing well today. I do want to welcome you to Maple Springs Baptist Church. I'm Tracy. I'm the youth pastor here at Maple Springs. I do want to welcome you because you could have been so many other places today, but you chose to be here at Maple Springs. Here at Maple Springs, where our goal really is to help you grow in your relationship with Jesus Christ. That's the whole reason that we exist here in Maple Springs, just to watch people grow. What a joy that is to see people grow in Christ Jesus. With that said, let's open up with a quick word of prayer, and then we'll stand and we'll sing. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank you for today. Father, we thank you for the time that you've given us this morning that we can come together as family. Father, what an opportunity that you've given us, Father. And I pray that we don't take that for granted, not one moment, Father. Again, Father, we thank you. And we ask all this in Christ's name. Amen.
There is an endless song echoes in my soul. I hear the music ring. And though the storms may come, I am holding on to the rock I cling. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King. And it makes my heart wanna sing. I will lift my eyes in the darkest night, for I know my Savior lives. And I will walk with you, knowing you'll see me through and sing the songs you. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart wanna sing.
I can sing in the troubled times, sing when I win. I can sing when I lose my step and fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up. Sing 'cause you're there. Sing 'cause you hear me, Lord, when I call to you in prayer. I can sing with my last breath. Sing 'cause I know that I'll sing with the angels and the saints around the throne.
How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart. I am loved the King, and it makes my heart. I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart wanna sing.
Thank you.
Just a couple of quick announcements that we do have. First of all, ministry opportunities that we have right here in our own area, that is our opportunity to love God and love our community. First of all is Southern Randolph, the Christians United of Southern Randolph County. We do the food pantry. If you notice as you walked in, there's all kinds of canned goods back there. We continue to collect that stuff. And then if you look to the other side, there's a large tower of paper products. That's for the Family Crisis Center that we do through the Randolph Baptist Association and the Women's Ministry here in Maple Springs. And also there's other things going on with the Women's Ministry. You'll just see Miss Sandra, she'll point you to that direction. And then finally, we still are going on with through all the way to Father's Day. We're doing the Your Choices Randolph bottle campaign. where we're collecting money in baby bottles for Your Choices Randolph. What a ministry that is. I do encourage you to latch on to one of those or all three if you want to. But another way that you can help right here at Maple Springs and our community and even going even further than that is giving. Giving here at Maple Springs. At the end of service today, you have the opportunity to do that. It's the buckets back there in the back, what those are for. Or you can go online and give on Tithely. Or you can simply drop it by or even mail it in if you need to. But what great opportunities that we have right here in Maple Springs to touch our community. You know, and we have the opportunity to worship through our giving and to mimic what God has done for us in giving. One of the best giving stories that I've ever heard is through the Bible. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave. He gave to us. He gave us His most precious gift, His Son, that whoever believes in Him will have eternal life. But He gave. What an opportunity that we have to be able to give give our very best back to Him as we do that and worship Him through that. So I'd ask that you do that. And we don't expect visitors to give. But with that said, any undesignated funds today will go to the cemetery fund. For this upcoming year for upkeep of the cemetery. And then that leads me into the last thing, our prayer request. I'm not going to take up prayer requests today. We'll do that tonight as we come together for Bible study tonight. But there is one name that I want to make sure that we have in front of us on our hearts. That's Miss Ann Davis. They have called hospice in. I'd ask that you pray for her. I ask that you pray for the entire family as they go through this time. And we need to make sure that we are the church to them as they walk through this time. So with that said, let's go to the Lord in prayer and we'll have another song. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank You. Father, I thank You for the opportunity that we have to come together as family. Father, I thank You for the opportunities that You give us to be able to minister to our surrounding areas, to minister to all the different fingertips, Father, that Maple Springs reaches out to. Father, we thank You for that. And Father, we thank You for all that You do for us, Father. You have done so much for us, even stuff that we don't even see that's right in front of us, Father. We can't even fathom the things that are going on that You have Your hands on and around, that You're controlling, dear Lord, and we thank You for that. And Father, this morning, as we do mention one of our very own, Father, Miss Ann, Father, I ask that You be with her. Father, I ask that You be with that entire family as they step through this time. Father, help us to be the church and to reach out to them and be there for them as they walk through this time, dear Lord. Father, I just ask that You give them everything that they need as they walk through this time. And Father, I ask that You be with us now as we step through this time of worship, Father, as we continue to worship You this morning. Father, help us to fix our eyes on You this morning. Help us to fix our hearts on You this morning so that we see only You. Father, that we only hear You. Father, that's our prayer as we move forward. Father, that we hear You and we feel You right here, dear Lord. Lead us and guide us in that. And we ask all this in Christ's precious and most powerful name.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't Jesus, You brought heaven down. My sin was great, Your love. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory.
Life is like a painting, every decision a stroke of the brush, every choice another hue. But the final outcome of our decisions may leave the portrait of our lives haphazard and blotched, like a defaced Picasso, meant to be a masterpiece. Our decisions are sometimes smears rather than strokes. We splatter the paint rather than dip the brush. We forget perspective and proportions, and we skew our colors. We are not even sure of the image we want, confused by a world filled with caricature. The art all around us can't be what we're meant to look like. We want to be different, but the portrait of our lives is stained in our own blood and tears. It fills the canvas with the reality of our own shortcomings. But there is hope. There is a master painter whose own strokes cover the world and every canvas in it. This painter gives us the tools to steady our hands and the instructions to change the haphazard and blotched strokes of our own shortcomings into an arabesque of colors. Life is like a painting, and we're meant to be different.
Well, welcome to Maple Springs. We're glad you're here this morning, and you guys can smile. It's okay. I know sometimes church, you're like, don't break a smile. But we're glad to see you on this homecoming Sunday. And I was thinking about this, put it in perspective. You got to put life in perspective. A year ago, somebody would say, well, we didn't have homecoming. No, it was on video. And it wasn't much of a homecoming. Nobody can come. And so think about how much farther we've come, and that's good. And I look out and I see people like, you haven't been in church in a year, and that's more than a year, and that's great that you can come out now, and I'm happy for you. But that's the 2021 version of what's going on, and I know it's not the way we used to do it, but the world's not the way it used to be either. So we're glad you're here. We're in a series that you just saw the bumper for it. Heroes from Zeros, and it's been a look at people, ordinary people in difficult circumstances of their lives, and how they fit into the life story of Jesus Christ, because he's really the biggest hero in all these stories. But we're looking into stories that you've probably heard before, because you've probably read the Bible. If you've not, they're not the big stories. They're not the real famous ones, although the one today we're going to talk about is somewhat famous. But the people in there, some of them don't even have names. Last week we looked at Mother's Day at a woman who was just a mom. She wasn't even a Jewish mom, and the Bible doesn't give us her name at all. And so that's what we have that's what we're at. And today we're going to look at it in light of our homecoming. Now, I know some of you guys will call it Memorial. I don't like to call it Memorial Sunday because I don't want to get confused with Memorial Day, which happens at the end of the month as a national holiday and all that. So we'll call it homecoming. It looks a little bit easier in my mind. It fits in, you'll see in our text today. But we're glad you're here nonetheless. But I want to start off by asking a simple question that maybe, hopefully, we'll resolve a little bit about. It's a question that's on everybody's mind, even if you're looking online and you're not here with us, or you're not a Christ follower and you're just sort of like, what are they doing there at that church? Here's the question is, if this is all life's all about, does it really matter? Does it really matter? I mean, I hate to be that downer today, but that's really where we're at in 2021. Does life really matter? And the answer that I'm going to give you, and this is your hope for today, because we always want to deal in hope. By the way, the mission of Maple, as clear as we can get it, what Tracy told you this morning, is we want to lead people into a growing relationship with Jesus. That's it. Simple as we can say it. We're here to lead people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ, because that's what he wanted us to do. There's a lot of other things you can do, and they're great and all that, and I think sometimes churches, we get confused by what we're supposed to be doing, but according to what Jesus wanted, he wanted us to lead people into a growing relationship with him, and that's as simple as I can say it. And everybody needs that, from the person who's been with Jesus the longest, we still need to help lead that, to people who've never met Jesus before, and that's what we're here to do. So hopefully you want to join us on that journey, we encourage you to that. But really, in 2021, and some of you have had a really bad week this week, I'll just be honest with you, it's been a tough week. I feel like that's sort of been a little bit in my life, things going on, but those are circumstances, but God's bigger. Amen. Let me just say that, so we don't want to feel, I don't want to wallow in pity. God's bigger than anything, that's what I've learned this week. But you know what, when you look at 2021, and then you start thinking about 2020 and what we've gone through and how we are and election cycles and pandemics and craziness, I mean, just this last week, you know, last Sunday, everything was fine and dandy. We heard about this whole story about some pipeline and all that, and then the next thing you know, people don't have, they're putting Ziploc bags full of unleaded gasoline together. Isn't that crazy? We live in some crazy times, and you might sit back and look at you might look at life and go, really? Is this what life's really all about? Is this it? I mean, is this the best we have? And let me just tell you, I always give you one takeaway today, and here it is, because I'm going to give it to you at the beginning, so we get this out of the way, so I guess you could sleep through this and if you don't want to listen to me, but here it is. You were created on purpose for a purpose. Did you get that? Now, I know some of you grew up in church and like, that's nothing new, I knew that. Or maybe you got a hold of that Purpose-Driven Life book and you read that and that's great, because he says the same thing in that. But embrace that today, because we don't always think that. Even if you're not a Christ follower and you're listening today, even if you've never done anything in church, you're not churchy or whatever, I want you to hear what I've got to say, because I think you would agree with me. You were created on purpose, and I know that might offend you if you don't believe in God the Creator, but you were created on purpose for a purpose. That's the truth behind what we know today. And you say, what's that got to do with homecoming? Because all those people that are marked by tombstones over there, and really not just there, but every tomb around the country, they all understood that, and they even understand it even more clearly today. But the reason if you came back here for Homecoming Sunday is because you realized there was something special about somebody that affected you at Maple, and you're celebrating that memory of them. Whether they're buried here and a family member, or maybe they are still living and just came to hang out with them. But the truth of the matter is, there is a divine purpose that they knew about, and they even know even greater now that they're in his presence. You were created on purpose for a purpose, but here's the problem. We've lost a little sight of that lately. See, 2020 and the pandemic and all the things that have ensued politically, with all the rights of all the different groups and people clamoring for attention, and I need this to happen in my life and that to happen, and I'm not here to talk about any of those things today. I'm just going to address them. They're happening, whether we like it or not, and whether you agree with it or not, they're happening. They've caused us to really change, even in church. We've withdrawn. See, the world when I grew up is not at all like it. Do you agree with that? The world that I grew up in is not at all like the world today. And I'm shocked. I was talking to J.A. before service, and I was just, is this really the world I grew up in? Because I never would have thought it would have gotten to this point today, and I'm not just here to say boo-hoo about that, but I'm just, wow. And then if I look in the book of Revelation, it's going to get a lot worse, and I'm like, can it? Yes, it can. I know that. But man, how bad? Wow. But as we look at this, when I go back to that statement, you were created on purpose for a purpose, it gives us this one thing that we have to think about, impact. 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 See, why you're here is that cemetery next to us had impact on your life. The people, not this pastor, but the people before, pastors and deacons and members for generations have had impact on your life. That's why you're here, isn't it? I mean, think about it. Maybe you don't have that kind of connection. Maybe you came because, like, there's somebody sitting next to you that's had that impact on your life today. That's what we're called to do. That's what Jesus wants for us. And that's really what a homecoming is all about. If I were going to define impact as clearly as we could, just so we get it out of the way, in terms of Christians, this is what a Christian would say an impact is when your life touches someone else's life and draws them closer to Jesus. Boy, doesn't that sound like the mission of Maple? This is the mission God gave us, isn't it? So impact's when my life touches your life and it draws you closer to Jesus. That's the whole idea, and that's what Jesus said. So if we have that to be our truth today, that we start off, because you were designed on purpose for a purpose, if that's the foundational truth of what we're going to talk about today, then we have to ask questions is, am I making a difference in somebody's life today? Or better yet, what would people lose if they lost me? That's a great question for you to ask yourself. And that's the question I want you to dwell on today. If your neighborhood, your community, your church, your business, all the things, your family, what would they lose if they lost you today? Because that's what we celebrate today with the people in that cemetery right next to us, isn't it? I mean, that's just the truth. And what effects am I having on this world? What effects am I having on other people? Because here's the problem as I see it. 2020 has created a different way of life, hasn't it? And I know, Friday afternoon, we got some orders and things are changed, and that's great. Everybody's happy somewhat. There's people that are mad. I'm not here to discuss those. But things are changing constantly. In fact, they're changing so much that they don't even know what to do. And that's scary. But here's the deal. Life used to be so much fun, right? You get with your family and friends for holidays, celebrations. Churches had big get-togethers, right? Big blowouts, and then pandemic hit. And our world got a little smaller. We started talking about all the other countries of the world that had it and got hit, and then it started coming here to the United States, and our world got a little smaller, didn't it? Every step of the journey, we had losses along the way, didn't we? Some of you lost family members in the last year. There are people that lost jobs, lost income. People lost respect for themselves, the way they lived. We lost political battles. And loss after loss after loss, what happened is our world kept getting smaller and smaller and smaller. We lost control of how we do things. We bought all the toilet paper on the shelves at Walmart and nobody had anything to use. And now we're buying gasoline so nobody has anything to use. And what those are symptoms of the problem that as 2020 came in and gave us this pandemic, our world got so much smaller to the point where your world now is just about you. And that's the problem of 2021. And that's exactly the opposite of the way God designed us to be, because you were created on purpose for a purpose. Mark chapter 2 is where we're at. If you have your Bibles or if you don't, just watch the words up here. Mark chapter 2, a story you've probably heard before. It helps us understand this. And actually, it's Jesus' homecoming because the Bible says so. I'm going to read the first 12 verses, and we're going to go from there. Verse number 1 says, a few days later, he's just giving us some time to understand the context of it. But Mark chapter 2 says, a few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum. Now, it says, the people that heard he had come home. Homecoming. You get it now? That's the homecoming. Now, some of you guys are like, wait a minute. I thought he was from Bethlehem. Jesus was from Bethlehem. His house and lineage was from Bethlehem. He was born in Bethlehem. His parents, though, ended up moving to Nazareth as he grew up. But Nazareth, when he began his ministry, was not his home. He ended up relocating to Capernaum because it was a better place. They accepted him a little bit better, but it was a better place to centralize his ministry. So Capernaum is his home as far as what he's doing as an adult. That's just a brief explanation, all we need to say about that. Verse number 2, it says, they gathered in large numbers that there was no room left, not even in the outside the door, and he preached the word to them, and everybody lived happily ever after. Story over, right? Great homecoming Sunday message, preacher, thanks. Yeah, that's not it, though, okay? You know that, because that's just the setting. But that is a homecoming, isn't it? Jesus comes to town, people get excited, he held the service, everybody comes, there's so many people there that they fill the windows, there's so many people you can't even get in. It's packed. I was thinking only probably a handful of times in my life I've ever been in places where I preached that we had that kind of response, and none of them were in America. So that's an American thing, I guess, but it is an exciting thing. I remember preaching one time where people were literally hanging on the bars on the windows, and it was so hot. There was probably 700-800 people in that small building, a little smaller than this place, so it was awesome. It was hot, though. Let's keep going, though. Verse number 3, some men came bringing to him, that is to Jesus, a paralyzed man carried by four of them. Since they could not get to him, since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowered the mat the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, son, your sins are forgiven. Now, some teachers of the law were sitting there thinking to themselves, why does this fellow talk like that? They're just thinking that. They haven't said it. He's blaspheming. Who can first forgive sins but God alone? And that's the problem. So these lawyers, and when you say lawyers in the Bible, don't think of a lawyer like in today's setting. These are people who are religious because the law was the law of Moses. They have studied it. They've memorized it. They're the ones, when people had a question about, like, what does the Bible say? You go to these guys. And so they're sitting there having this little conversation in their mind saying, what? He's forgiving sins? Who does he think he is? God's the only one that can do that. He's got a little bit more of it, thinks more of himself than he should. And that's blasphemy. So that's the thinking they have. So verse 8, immediately Jesus knew in his spirit that this was what they were thinking in their hearts. And he said to them, why are you thinking these things? Which is easier, to say this to this paralyzed man, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up, take your mat, and walk? So he's basically giving us this whole, like, oh yeah, I know anybody could walk up to this guy and go, your sins are forgiven. How do you prove that really happened? Because you don't see that happen. Wouldn't it be easy? Which would be easier? You could tell somebody their sins are forgiven or heal somebody, and that's the question. All right, if you're really God, why don't you heal somebody? And he says, but, verse 10, but, and I love this about God, he wants to clear up any confusion in our lives, but I want you to know, I don't want you to hope, I don't want you to just guess, I want you to know. If you don't know this today, Jesus wants you to know the truth. He wants you to know the truth about your eternal destiny. He wants to know that you, he wants you to know you can have a relationship with him. He wants you to know things more than you have. And that's the truth. He doesn't hide things from you. He wants you to know. He says, but I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. So I want you to know that. So how do I make sure you know that? He goes on. So he said to the man, turning to this paralytic man, he says, I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home. That's pretty bold. I mean, paralytic man, hasn't moved. I don't know how long, doesn't say any of that. Get up, pick up your mat, and go home. Straightforward. Verse 12, he got up, took his mat, and walked out in full view of them all. This amazed everyone. How many people? Everyone. Say everyone with me. Everyone. This amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, we have never seen anything like this. Wow. Is that impact or not? That's impact. I was looking through this thinking, like, how in the world is this going to happen on homecoming? Because, you know, you speak on days like this, and they got to fit, the message fits, and God just said, here it is, here it is. He came home, and he had impact. But we're in a series, Heroes from Zeros, and we always look at the people, and that's why I take just a second to talk about the different people, because there's so many different people here. Obviously, Jesus, because if you didn't know this, a lot of people have a problem with the Bible. The problem with the Bible is it's not just a lot of things. It's the meta-narrative of God. And that word meta-narrative, big $10 word, that means the big overarching story that has a lot of little stories in it of God. And your and my story, along with all the people in the Bible, our story in life is part of the smaller story of God's story, his meta-narrative. Our little stories fit into God's story, and that's how you have to look at it, and that's what we should understand. Because when we try and look at our own life apart from God, it gets really confusing and hard. So here we are in this whole series, and we start off, and we look at, and let's look at the first person that's easy to see. It's Jesus, right? Jesus, God in the flesh, comes to town, and everybody's excited about it because he's doing some pretty amazing things. That's why they referred to the time after a little while. You have to go back to the last chapter in Mark, chapter 1, and talks about some of the miracles he was doing. People were excited about it, so he draws a crowd. And God always draws a crowd because God is God. God does some amazing things, and Jesus was no exception. But really, let's just set aside, because we'll get back to Jesus in a minute. Let's talk about the next group that the story talks about, and that would be the crowd. Because you and I, a lot of times, we're in the crowd. We are. We're in the crowd in life. And crowds are good sometimes. Don't you miss crowds? In 2020, we missed crowds, didn't we? It was depressing when I looked at some of the football and basketball games and looked, when they're playing canned crowd clapping, I hate that. It's, ugh. Crowds. I mean, even this, don't you miss, didn't you miss full church services? I mean, I did. I get it. It's just something about the crowd. Although, we love the crowds, but sometimes, just to be honest, we don't like crowds, do we? What do I mean? When you're out trying to find a place at the local grocery store or whatever, and it's crowded, and you have to park and get a shuttle bus just to get to the store, you know what I'm saying? Ever been to Walmart before? It's not fun. And around the holidays, going any shopping anywhere is not fun a lot of times. When people get in there and they throw in elbows and pushing, you know, these little sweet ladies, they're throwing elbows and like they were professional wrestlers or something. Sometimes we don't like the crowd. And when we look at the story, we see a crowd here. And if I were going to talk about it, we talk about Jesus already, and I'll get back to him. But if Jesus has the title of God, so that means he in this story is going to be the healing person. He's the one that's the miracle worker. But when we look at the crowd, this great crowd who, hey, let's look at the positive things. They're excited about Jesus coming to town. They want to hear him. They gather for a church service at somebody's house. They're just all excited. In fact, they're so overwhelmed and excited that you can't even get close. They're standing room only. They've filled the windows. Everything's tight. And that's the problem. See, the crowd that you and I get into sometimes, we think we're helping, but we're not. Because really, the crowd is the hindering one, right? See, sometimes the crowds keep Jesus away. And in this case, or keep the people away from Jesus, let's put it that way. Sometimes, as the group of people that we fit into, that crowd, sometimes the religious crowd, because they were religious, hey, you know what, we do a good job sometimes keeping people far from Jesus. And that's the opposite of impact, isn't it? Because it wasn't impact when I touch your life and draw you closer to Jesus. But sometimes we do the opposite, and that's what this crowd's doing, isn't it? Because when you read that story once again, you look at it, you say, wait a minute, there's a crowd there, and they are so intent on hearing the message that they cared little or less about the person who needed the greatest help, didn't they? Next person we look at in the story is the guy that had the biggest problem, right? He's the paralytic, paralyzed. Scary, isn't it? I always was scared. Like, I don't know if anybody here, and I don't want to know probably, because it would scare me just to think about it, but I've got a fear of heights, okay? This is probably as high as I want to get, okay? I'm just serious. I'm so scared of heights, I would never try drugs. You'll get that in a minute. I don't like heights. I get queasy. So these people that are like, I thought it'd be cool to jump out of an airplane. Are you crazy? I'm not. I don't want to do that. And here's my fear. It's not that I would die. It's that I would live. And my parachute wouldn't open. Hey, somebody's laughing, man. Lisa, I see you. She's laughing. Yeah, that would be funny, the preacher. No, I'm serious. Being a paralytic, wow. Man, what kind of life do you have? You know, the paralytic represents every one of us here that one time or another, if you didn't know that. A paralytic person cannot move on and do anything for themselves. And according to what the Bible teaches us, that we, apart from Jesus Christ and that relationship, we're a paralytic. We're dead, really, is the way Paul put it. We have no ability to help ourselves. And that's what we find this guy. It doesn't tell us his name. It doesn't tell us where he lived, how far he had to go. He was just paralytic. And I'll be honest with you, and this is going to sound harsh, but in their day and age, a paralytic person was a burden to society and not useful at all. What's he going to do? He has no occupation. He has no income, no help. And somebody's got to feed him. He can't even, as a paralytic, he can't lift a spoon to help himself. Fork, he can't feed himself. He can't change himself. He can't do, no showering, none of those. I mean, the things you and I take for granted, and the Bible puts that as the picture of us in the days before we knew Jesus Christ and he helped us come to life. We couldn't come closer to Jesus if we wanted to. And that's a sad person. And right away, if you're looking at this thinking zeros, to heroes that he's got to be our zero. And yes, he is a zero, but he's not the one I want to focus on. The other group that we have to talk about that are really big zeros is those lawyers. They're the religious, and sometimes we're in that crowd too, even if we don't mean to be, because we want to follow all the traditions. We want to stay with the rules, preacher. Stay with the rules. Come on, we've got a certain way it has to be done. And Jesus fought these guys all the time. And they were to the point where they couldn't even recognize God when he was standing right there in front of them. They challenged his authority, and they called him up. How do you get somebody that calls Jesus a blasphemy? He's blaspheming. They weren't just hindering people. They were hurting people. And sometimes we've been in that group. We've gone beyond being the helpless man. We've gone beyond the crowd that's hindering people from getting to Jesus. And now we're hurting people as they try to get to Jesus because we're putting down Jesus. Which leaves us with a group I really want to talk about. The people that had the most impact in this story. And you probably guessed it already. Four guys. Nothing we know about them other than there are four of them. Four people. Their names aren't mentioned. Just what they did. Doesn't even tell us who they are as far as are they friends of this paralytic man or not. What is their role? What jobs they come from? But what we know is they had a compassion that was compelling. We always assume like they must have been good friends with this guy. It doesn't say that. I don't know. I don't even know. It doesn't say that they were devoted to disciples of Jesus Christ, but you get that idea. But what they did to me was amazing. Because they, first of all, picked up a guy. Now, once again, we don't know how big the paralytic guy is. He might have been somebody really small. Or it might have been somebody my size. If it's my size, it's even bigger that they did this. But I don't care. If you're carrying somebody's dead weight, their body weight, that's not an easy thing to do. Back 23 years ago, something like that, 23 years ago, I got into a sporting accident outside and crushed my ankle, my right ankle, and dislocated my left knee. Same time. I was not too far. The basketball court, I was living on church premises. We had a basketball court there. That's where it happened. And so the guys that I was with, they knew they couldn't pick me up. I'm just big. Because to them, they were all a lot smaller than me. So what they decided to do, and this I guess was pretty comical if you had seen it, they decided there's a sidewalk, let's just drag him all the way on the sidewalk to his house and let his wife deal with him. So here I am, and when I say crushed, there was nothing left of an ankle. Completely gone. Knee has been dislocated. I am screaming in pain, one of those kind of things. Crying, tears, it hurts so bad. So these guys, two of them are teenagers, one of them's another youth pastor at a church, they're just dragging me. And they're dragging me, like, grabbed a shirt, you know, just whatever. They knew they couldn't use my legs. I already told them that. And as they're dragging me, just happened to be that the deputy sheriff was doing a patrol and he came down the road. Think about that picture. Just think about that picture. A guy screaming on the ground with three guys dragging him. Yeah. So right away, you see this, and what I saw was the deputy sheriff's car go, stop. Oh, it went in reverse and pulled right in. Lights came on, and the guy jumped out. Like, and you could see he's putting his hand on his weapon. He's like, "What's going on, guys?" and they end up telling him. So he called an ambulance by then. The rest is not a good story. But anyway, the point was moving somebody who can't move for themselves is tough. Because I at least had my arm use, could help a little bit. But to pick up a body. And so these four guys come and find a paralyzed man. Don't know if he was friends. Don't know anything about him. Don't know his size. And they go, okay, the only help he's going to get, and they were clear on this, is from Jesus. So let's take him to Jesus. That's impact, right? Impact is when my life touches your life and draws you closer to Jesus. And that's what they said. We need to do this. So everybody grab a corner. And they started doing that. And I don't know. Hopefully he lived right next door. But what if he lived on the outskirts of town? What if you lived a half mile, 2 miles, 3 miles? How long did they go? I don't know, but they did it at their own cost. And when they get there, the crowd parted like the Red Sea, and they strolled in, and everybody's like, praise Jesus, let's heal them. Not at all. Remember, the crowd didn't care. Can you imagine? They walked up with this guy and said, hey, excuse me, we need to get to Jesus. He needs help. What would the crowd say? You don't understand. You should have come earlier with him. We got our seats today. You should have gotten yours. I'm not sliding over. This is my seat that my ancestors have sat in for years at my church. Not moving for you, buddy. And the crowd stayed put, didn't they? Because the crowd didn't care. But these guys, what I love about them is their resiliency. Because impact looks beyond the issues. And they said, you know what? If we can't get them in the direct way, let's go the indirect way. And so they took them up on top of the roof. And we're not going to get into all the construction styles and all that stuff. Just know this. It was just as crazy in their day to cut open a roof as it would be for me to do it to your house. It would have been. But that's what they did. I don't know if that guy had a sawzall or some heavy-duty construction equipment. He just started ripping. But the next thing you know, Jesus is standing there, and all of a sudden, I was thinking, like, what would happen if today I was standing here all of a sudden? Nobody's going to bring anybody like that to me because I can't heal anybody. But what if all of a sudden the roof opened up and somebody started lowering down? That would be crazy, wouldn't it? That'd be crazy. And I wonder, like, did Jesus stop right in the middle of his preaching? Go, hold on to that point right here. Let me wait. And how long did it take? Was it like, was it Mission Possible where the guy zipped him down? Or was it like 5 minutes later, you know? And how awkward was it for that guy? You know, all these people are staring at him. But anyway, he gets there and he's at Jesus' feet. And it's amazing because Jesus looks right at him and says, your sins are forgiven because of the faith of those guys. That's crazy. I came across a pastor who was talking about his life story, and he was telling the discouraging time in his life where he had no faith in God and he was ready to quit and everything this past week. And you know what he said? He went home to his pastor, his mentor, the guy he'd worked for. And this guy looked at him and said, he wanted to quit, wanted some help. The guy looked at him and said, hey, don't quit. Stay where you're at. It'll be okay. But he said, here's what I want to help you with. Your faith seems to be gone, so I want to help you by lending you some of mine. Whew. Have you ever lent somebody some faith? I was blown away by that. Because before you say, well, that's not biblical. No, it is, because that's what these four guys did for this paralytic guy. Jesus didn't say, hey, your sins are forgiven to you because of your great faith. No, he says, your sins are forgiven because of those four guys and their great faith in Jesus Christ. They lent him the faith for his sins to be forgiven. And I don't even know what sins they are. I don't know. Did his sin get him to the place where he was paralytic? I don't know. But that was the story of impact that I see here. And let me just drop you a few little things as we finish up. Number one, what do you need to know? The problem with us, and I told you, our world has shrunk so much over the last year that our world's become more about us than anything else. We worry about us and what's going on. And so we live this little tiny isolated life, which is exactly where Satan wants us to live. True impact, though, according to what we find here, is not about you. True impact is not about you. That's the first thing we realize. See, those four guys, don't help a paralytic man if they start thinking about them. They're thinking about, like, you know, I got back problems. I agree with that. This guy's heavy. We have to go a long way. You know what? Oh, we got there and they wouldn't let us in, so I guess we can't do anything else. No, true impact, they understood, was not about you. So what? It's about the person that you're helping. And ultimately, really, it's not even about that. It's about Jesus Christ. And for these guys to go from being zeros in our story, nobodies, just people in the crowd, just people going by, to being the heroes of our story today, what we realize is they realize that true impact is not about you, because they realize that statement that they were designed on purpose for a purpose. They weren't just accidents in life. That's the truth. See, 2020, life's been hard, hasn't it? Hasn't it? I mean, I'm just up here making up stuff. Life is so much harder today. You just don't know what crazy is going to happen on the news. What's going to happen in the government? What's going to happen economically? Hey, last week we had to deal with gasoline issues because somebody decided they're going to hold hostage the pipeline. That's crazy. But just because life's hard doesn't mean we don't have a calling to fulfill. And that's what these guys understood. Just because carrying a paralytic man is going to be hard doesn't mean you get out of it. Just because carrying a paralytic man is going to be hard because a crowd's standing in your way doesn't mean you get out of it. Just because carrying a paralytic man is going to be hard and you might have to cut into a roof and lower him down is going to be really hard in first century Palestine doesn't mean you get out of it. And our calling doesn't change just because the world is hard today, guys. Those people out there in that cemetery, they didn't have an easy life. They paved the way for us. And you know what they would tell us if they were here today? They say, you're right, preacher. Just because the world's hard doesn't mean we get an easy calling. Hey, it doesn't mean you get to ignore things. And yet, that's what we've done, isn't it? See, the second thing, the second truth I would want you to see out of this story today is the fact of what these guys knew. That the gospel message is too big for us to live small lives. And that's what we've been doing. That's what 2020 did to us. We started living a very small life, worrying about whether we're going to be infected, whether we're going to be sick, whether we're going to have money, whether we're going to have... And we live this life now that is so me-focused. And remember what I said? Our world is getting so small because it's about us, and it's not supposed to be. So those four guys, you know what they knew? That message that Jesus is in there preaching, that healing he's willing to provide is so big that he's got to get there. And the gospel is so big that we can't live it in our small little lives without doing it differently. That's the truth. The gospel's too big for us to live in small lives. And so they had to change their approach. And basically, these guys said, go big or go home. And they said, let's go big. The gospel needs to be presented. And you know what I found? These are just truths that God's put in my life. We've adapted and adjusted to small living. Small living. We're afraid to talk to people about Jesus Christ. We're afraid to do things, ministry, about the cost it might cost us. We're afraid. And our world has gotten about us. And it's not about Jesus anymore. The gospel's too big for us to live small lives. See, these guys were moved somehow by God in their hearts, and Jesus motivated them to action, and that's really how impact happens. Because remember, I said to get back to this guy, Jesus. Jesus is really the guy, the hero of the story. He always is. Even though these four guys did great things, if Jesus isn't there, they don't do anything. That's the truth. And Jesus has to be the hero of your story and my story. The problem is sometimes I let the crowds get in my way so I don't see Jesus. I don't think it's worth my time. I lose focus of what Jesus is all about. And Jesus is just here to heal you. He's here to forgive you. You know, in order to live a life of impact, you got to have a philosophy of being open-handed. And that's what these four guys were. They were open-handed. And living in a small world and a small life, we start getting closed-fisted. We think about our time. We think about our money. We think our this, our that. And that's the exact opposite of these four guys, isn't it? They said, let me give you a hand here. And they reached out their hands and lifted up a mat and moved a guy who couldn't get to Jesus. They ripped open a roof. They lowered him down. They did things that were just crazy because they realized in order to have impact, you got to live open-handed. When we get that small-mindedness that 2020 and 2021 have really taught us, we stop doing things. We stop having the impact. We stop doing what comes. The reason you're here today is in memory of people that are buried out there and their lives that touched us because they lived open-handed in your life. In fact, if you dare say, whether you're a Christ follower or not, if you dare say this, the greatest people that ever lived in your life were the people who were most open-handed in your life, right? Usually it was probably your mom, your dad, somebody great in your life. I hope it was a Christ follower. In my family story, it was a neighbor kid across the street. He lived open-handed by making friends with my brother. He invited my brother to church. And so my mom and dad said, yeah, go ahead. And then he invited my oldest brother. And then my sister tagged along. And so my mom thought she better find out what those crazy people at the church are doing. And the next thing I know, our whole family's going. I was just a baby at the time, so that's why you don't hear much about me. But because of that open-handed invitation that helped us get to Jesus, the impact on my life was because someone's life touched my life and got me closer to Jesus. Amen. Ultimately, you're designed on purpose, for a purpose. That's what the people out there knew, and that's why you're here today. That's what it's all about. So practically, what does that mean for us? When we think about the practical aspects, what we have to realize is the gospel is too big for us to live small lives, but the gospel isn't seen so often. So what we need to do is get the gospel seen. And the Bible says the gospel message, the good news of Jesus, is seen when we do good works before other people and glorify your Father. That's the truth. It was the good works of these four men in carrying a paralytic, cutting open a roof. I mean, I was thinking, if I were there in the story, somewhere the person who owned the house probably was ranting and raving, going, "What? You just ripped open my house. How am I going to get this fixed? It's going to cost me money." You don't hear any of that in the story, do you? Why? Because the whole crowd, by the time it's over, remember we read it, everyone was amazed. And everyone praised God, even the guy that owned the house. Why? Because when you show your good works that glorify God, the gospel is revealed to everybody. So practically this week, what should we do? We need to learn how to pray open-handed prayers. Open-handed prayers. You say, what's an open-handed prayer? Most of our prayers sound like this. God, I need this. Can you give me this? Can you heal this for me and work this out for me and do this? We need to start praying some open-handed prayers. God, give me someone to help today. God, would you make me like one of these four guys who helped a paralytic man? God, give me opportunities. God, help me see people the way you see people. God, help me to be the person that can share your word. Hey, you don't want to change your life? Start praying some open-handed prayers. And then number two, find a place where you can make impact. And what's impact? When your life touches someone else's life and draws them closer to Jesus. Because that's the mission of Maple. Let me have every head bowed and every eye closed. Our hero today is Jesus Christ, obviously. Because without him, it's not possible. He healed. He forgave. He's it. But we got to talk about those other guys because they did a great job. Because we're talking about impact today. I start off asking that question, is this all that there is to life? And I told you I wanted to answer that question. No, there's so much more. Because Jesus actually makes life so much bigger and better. So, let me just say this. If you've been listening today, I hope you were sitting back going, I wonder which one I am in. Because at different times and different stages of my life, I've been in different groups. Obviously, we've all been the paralytic, and I want to start there. Right now, if you don't know Jesus Christ, if you haven't come in contact with him, if you don't have a relationship with him, that's the very first starting place. There was a day in my life that I was a paralytic, and I had to come to Jesus. Somebody brought me there to that point. And Jesus said, son, your sins are forgiven. And then he said, get up and walk. And I did. Now, that's all metaphorically as a spiritual person, but that's where we're all at. And so if you don't know Jesus Christ, your Savior, I'm going to invite you today. Hey, today would be the greatest day, a homecoming day, because we're all at one point or another far from home. That is far from God. And so I invite you, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, hey, we'd like to show you how you can know beyond a shadow of doubt, not a hope, not a feeling, not being a good person. I want you to know that you can know Jesus Christ, that you can have this relationship. Because my friend, if you don't let Jesus heal you, you're doomed. And I know nobody wants to hear that, but that's the truth. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except by me. Your good works don't get you there. Being a nice person doesn't get you there. Having a lot of friends on social media doesn't get there. Being the life of the party doesn't get you there. It is a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's it. And so we want that for you. And so we desperately ask, if you don't know Jesus, please, we want to take time to show you. Someone here For most of us, though, as Christ followers, hey, I got to ask, are you in the crowd? Because though you may like to hear about Jesus and you might like his messages and see the miracles, you might be hindering people from coming to Jesus too. So are you hindering, or have you been impactful? If the world lost you today, what would they really lose? That's the question you need to be asking yourself. That's just the truth. Are you one of the experts in the law? I grew up in church and I know all the traditions. Yeah, but are you one of the experts in the law? Because those experts in the law, they didn't even believe Jesus. They thought he was a blasphemer. They were hurting people. Or are you one of the helpful ones? The ones that were making impact? Evaluate where you're at. Those people that you came to honor today, if they were looking on, they'd say, hey, have an impact. Have an impact. I'm not talking about have your name made famous. I'm talking about making Jesus famous. That's the impact. Touching another person's life and drawing them to Jesus. That's the only thing. So who are you doing that to now? Or are you still using the excuse that COVID's keeping you from doing what Jesus called you to do? That's sad. Let's do something better. You were created, designed on purpose, for a purpose. Let's live out our purpose. God, we thank you for what you do for us. We thank you for your word and how it impacts our lives. So help us today as we think about what we're called to do, that your Holy Spirit would touch our lives. And God, we do more than just attend meetings at church. We do more than just sit in the pew. We do more than just donate a few dollars, that we'd actually touch somebody else's life to draw them closer to you. God, help us to stop living in that small realm of just us and help us to be full of impact, because we don't want to keep being zeros. We want you to be our hero and to be heroes just like you. So let us lift you up today. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand. We're going to sing a verse of invitation. If God's speaking to your heart, and I can't believe that God isn't speaking to somebody today, listen carefully. Do what he wants. As we sing, I surrender all. Oh.